Achette Audio presents The Church Awakening, An Urgent Call for Renewal. Written by Charles R. Swindoll. Read by Dennis Holland. It is with heartfelt gratitude for his life and ministry that I dedicate this book to Dr. Stanley D. Toussaint, whom I have learned from as an outstanding professor, always admired as a biblical expositor, greatly respected as a wise mentor, and now serve with as a fellow elder at Stonebriar Community Church. When the church is absolutely different from the world, she invariably attracts it. It is then that the world is made to listen to her message, though it may hate it at first. D. Martin Lloyd-Jones. Introduction. Here is the great evangelical disaster, the failure of the evangelical world to stand for truth as truth. There is only one word for this, namely accommodation. The evangelical church has accommodated to the world spirit of the age. Francis Schaeffer. While we weren't paying attention, everything became unhinged. Our world is no longer the world of our grandparents, or of our parents for that matter. While we weren't noticing, things were changing, or perhaps I should say, they were eroding. We slipped from what we used to call a modern world into a postmodern world without even realizing it. We've drifted from a Christian era into a post-Christian era. That's why we find ourselves in a world that is less friendly to the church and more than ever disconnected from the Bible. So it's no surprise that today's citizen is more biblically ignorant than people of virtually any other time since the Dark Ages. All of us remember watching The Tonight Show with Jay Leno. Much of what Leno did was tasteless and over the top, but that's how he kept his ratings up. One night Leno was engaged in one of his on-the-street interviews. It was hilarious and tragic at the same time. He went out to the streets and asked unsuspecting people about the Bible. The questions weren't hard or tricky. In fact, they were designed to be easy. That's what made it so funny. Leno asked one person, "Did Adam and Eve have any children?" A woman, after a few seconds of deep thought, said, No, they never had any kids." "Name the two brothers, Cain and..." Absolute blank stare. Had no idea. They probably were thinking Cain and Hurricane or something like that. No, she had no answer. "Okay, what happened to Lot's wife?" Zero response. And then one of the bystanders blurted out, "Who was Lot?" Little hint, she turned into, the person said, an angel. Leno turned to someone else. "Can you name one of the apostles?" No reply. He continued, "Okay, then name the four Beatles." Immediate response, John, Paul, George, and Ringo. The crowd cheered. "How many commandments are there?" One guy boldly announced, "Three. There are three commandments." Another person said, "No, there are 20. 20 commandments. Another one said, "No, it's like the disciples. There were 12. "Can you name four of them?" asked Leno. Nobody could name four. "Can you name one of them?" And one fellow said, "Something about not coveting your neighbor's wife." Interesting, he remembered that one. Jay said, "You mean if she's pretty?" And he said, "Yeah, I think that's it." Jay said, "Is your neighbor's wife pretty?" The man said, "No, she's not pretty." I thought, I wonder if the neighbor's wife is watching. "Who was swallowed by a whale?" "A whale?" was asked. "This some kind of trick question?" "No, let me give you a hint. Joan of Arc," was the quick response. "No, Joe DiMaggio." "No, Pinocchio." Jay pressed on. "Which two cities were destroyed according to the book of Genesis? Let me give you a hint. Sodom..." After a brief pause, the person on the street guessed, "Saddam Hussein?" Our world is not only ignorant of the basic facts of the Bible. Most now are skeptical, convinced there is no such thing as absolute truth. The deception is so subtle we can be led to believe that what is wrong is right, and what is bad is, in fact, good. And tragically, most people don't realize either until it is too late. Ours is a whole new world, and nothing has been more adversely affected by postmodernism than the church and its relationship to God's Word, the Holy Scriptures. When the Bible loses its central place in the church's worship, even if good things replace it, the fallout is biblical ignorance. The longer substitutes replace the preaching of the Word as the centerpiece of Christian worship, the more we will witness the drift into ignorance intensifying. The more postmodern thinking dominates the church, the weaker and less important the church becomes in the eyes of the world. Over time, a congregation that is distant from the Word of God seeks more entertainment and less biblical truth. One astute observer notes, when the church becomes an entertainment center, Bible literacy is usually an early casualty. People go away from the event with a smile on their face, but a void in their life. Decades ago, the theologian Francis Schaeffer wrote, "Here is the great evangelical disaster, the failure of the evangelical world to stand for truth as truth. There is only one word for this, namely, accommodation. The evangelical church has accommodated to the world spirit of the age." The good news? It can change. The church awakening is a call for the church to become aware of how far we have drifted. The time has come to wake up and renew our passion for what Jesus is building. This new volume stems from my firm belief that we can stop the church's drift only when God's people commit to following the inspired blueprint set forth in God's timeless and ever-relevant book. I have written The Church Awakening primarily to two groups of people. First, to serious-thinking churchgoers who know there is a better way. In the Bible, there was a group of clear-thinking, tough-minded men called the Sons of Issachar, 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. They were those who understood the times and knew what Israel should do, verse 32. We need that same clear-headed discernment today in the church. And along with discernment, we need an equal supply of courage. My aim is to ignite that passion within those who are willing to think seriously. I am also writing to pastors, especially to those who are on the fence, who need a voice of permission to buck the tide and to put the preaching of the Word of God back in its central place of the church's worship. I'm concerned about the intensifying embrace of postmodernism. The result of this is that we have eroded from a Christian era to a post-Christian era. I remember when we used to say that about Great Britain. I now say it about the United States of America, the land I love, a land I have served to help protect. But over the past 30 years, we have slid into the murky waters of a post-Christian swamp. Instead of life being interpreted honestly, it is now interpreted emotionally. Instead of real being real, virtual reality has taken charge. And since the reality is now distorted and viewed as distasteful, the younger generation prefers virtual reality. Reality bores them. We have changed our thinking based on objective instruction from the truth of Holy Scripture to the subjective, secular thinking based squarely on a horizontal, humanistic perception where self is always predominant. Need a good definition of postmodernism? Let's see if I can hammer one out for you. A description might be more helpful than a definition. Postmodernism thrives on chaos. It desires to destroy all moral criteria and replace it with no criteria. It seeks a world in which everything is relative, where there is no truth, and perception alone is reality. Since God's eternal truth has no place in such a world, with the rise of postmodernism, we witness a commensurate decline in biblical knowledge. The way this has evolved is interesting. Postmodernism began in the rarefied atmosphere of the academic literary community. It soon began to ooze from the erudite eggheads in academia to virtually everyone in any position of leadership. It has morphed from the halls of academia to the halls of Congress, to the halls of public schools, and finally into our private homes. We're now submerged in this philosophy of thinking, a form of thinking that is both insidious and subtle. No big-time public announcement will ever be made. We are now embracing postmodernism. It doesn't come in like that. It comes like a thief in the night. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 2. The greatest tragedy of all is that the evangelical church of the 21st century has capitulated. the slumbering evangelical church has now bought into this way of thinking. I hope to explain why and how in this audiobook. But let me add, I did not write this book just to point out all that's wrong. That is not my intention. My writing has always had an emphasis on grace, which is God's emphasis in the Bible. I intend each chapter to address solutions, not just expose problems, and to point to the hope that God offers in His Word. In my almost 50 years in ministry, I have never been more passionate or hopeful for the church awakening.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.